Hey space travelers, are you ready to go on discovery with me and learn about moon colonization? Or are you afraid to discover the whole truth? You've seen the movies, you read the books, you thought about it. Having a colony on the moon is one of those things that will happen eventually. Question is, how are we going to accomplish this? What it would take to establish a permanent settlement on the moon? And what it would take to build a city on the moon? These are the main subjects that we will speculate a lot about. If humanity is to survive, we need to colonize our solar system. So, colonizing the moon seems like a first step in that journey. We are going to talk about life on Mars, Venus, and even Titan in the following videos. So, if you like these videos, consider subscribing to not miss those very intriguing videos as well. Now, relax, get comfortable, and enjoy the video. It's been close to 50 years since a humanity stood on the moon. Only 12 people managed to stand on the surface of our companion. If we are to colonize that bad boy, we need to pump those numbers up. First, we need to return to the moon. We need a plan with many steps. Step 1 will be sending supplies to a convenient place. There are many good spots where we can build our settlements. The spot we should choose is pretty close to the North Pole. Why that place exactly will become clear in a bit. So, we send the supplies and we send the astronauts. Now, we need to discuss how they'll start to build a base. When living on celestial objects, it has nothing that will help us to survive. We need to solve that problem first. The most important thing we need on the moon is the internet. I mean, come on, don't tell me that anybody can survive without the internet for more than a few seconds. Thankfully, the satellite systems will allow us to connect to the World Wide Web using a pretty strong router device. That Wi-Fi router will need energy. We can make unlimited energy with the solar panels that we will send with one of our supply ships. We now have unlimited energy. Well, as long as no asteroid hits our solar panels. The place we chose to set up our base is close to the North Pole of the Moon. The fun thing about the Moon's North Pole is the fact that it's always day there. So, we will have unending sunshine, except for a few times during the eclipse. After setting up the power-making machine, we can move on the other problems. We have the internet. Now, we need to breathe. We can bring some amount of air and also bring the technology to make more of it. Using plants would be good, but using phytoplankton will be great. You might not know it, but it's actually the phytoplankton that makes the majority of the oxygen on Earth. We can use both of these to start producing air on the moon. That way, we can solve that problem. Next, we need water for us and the planktons. Sending enough water on the moon to sustain even the smallest of the settlements will be extremely expensive. So, instead we could use the other advantages the location of our base offers. In 2018, NASA scientists proved that there is water on the moon. It is frozen, but we can use that sweet solar energy to heat the ice, and voila, we have water. And since we are on the North Pole, that is the place where the most amount of ice will be. So far, we have air, water, and the internet. Now, we need something to eat. Some of the plants we'll use for the oxygen creation can also be a type of plant that also produces food. As Mark Watney did in the movie Martian, we could farm potatoes on the moon. The soil might be a problem, but some scientists already proved that a lunar soil can be used to farm plants. We would need a lot of fecal matter to make the soil fertile, but the problem is solved by sending people there. This means that we have solved all short-term problems. This basic infrastructure – solar panels, ice-melting machines, plants, phytoplanktons, and farms – can give the first settlers of the moon enough time to start building a shelter. Up until this time, we could have stayed in the rocket. Now, we need to go further. Since the moon doesn't have the atmosphere, any building built on it needs to have some sort of protection against the sun rays. Even on Earth, if you stay too long directly under the sunlight, you will get a sunburn. Now, imagine how much worse a sunburn can be if there was no atmosphere. Spacesuit alone will not be enough. So, this is the next problem we need to solve. There are two ways we could hide from the solar radiation. The first would be to dig a hole and start building the base there. But since the CIA already did that, let's not repeat it and go with the second option. And that second option is some sort of a barrier, which catches or redirects the bad sun rays and let the good rays pass through them. Almost every depiction of a base on the moon has some sort of dome. But this dome won't be made of glass, as many people would think. Rather, it will be made of hydrogen-based cloth. As to what that is, I have no idea either, but it exists, apparently. Think something like a mithril armor from the Lord of the Rings, but transparent and dome-shaped. This will solve the radiation problem. Next, we need to start building structures. We could send already made IKEA-style bunkers just like you see in The Martian. The problem with that is the price. Yeah, we can send one or two, even the three of these buildings, but any more would be a waste of money. Why do that when instead we can send a machine that will build buildings itself? 3D printing a house is already pretty affordable. Scientists from Europe already developed the technology to build buildings using the same type of soil that the moon has. So, the buildings we build will be made out of the moon itself. These buildings need to be strong and modern. We would first need to invent a new branch of architecture. We can call it celestial architecture. And these new building types will be the most useful, sturdy, and futuristic that we can make. It also has to have a lot of room for development, because new things are being invented every day. So these moon bases need to be flexible enough to be updated every few months. We have a settlement and everything else we might need to survive. What else do we need then? Well, we need to travel back in time. Yeah, I know, I just pulled a Christopher Nolan on you. But I bet your mind already went into the thoughts of how would we finance such an event. And just like many other things in this video, we have more than one option. First is the traditional way. NASA and the money of the US taxpayers, maybe even the European Union, can join. In a significantly better world, China and Russia will also be part of this. But considering the current tension between the US and these two, that's unlikely. The other option is a private way. You know the one. He's named Elon Musk, and his rival, Jeff Bezos, could use their immense wealth and finance the moon colonization. If they work together, that would make the colonization easier. But I bet that's even more unlikely than the US, China, and Russia working together. In either option, innovation in space travel and communication needs to get faster. SpaceX is already working on that. So, what I am proposing is a consensus between the innovative private companies and the government. This consensus can make it much easier for us to colonize the moon. This way, the private company can work on the innovation, and the government can work on legislation. This way, the moon will be claimed by an existing country, which will probably be better than a private company establishing a new sovereign entity. Getting back to the future. See what I did there? So far, we established a small colony on the moon. Now, we want to grow that settlement. Normally on Earth, the way small villages and towns grew was the incentives it gave to people. Scientists and workers will already be there for obvious reasons. if we let private space companies make tourist trips from the Earth to the Moon, eventually, as the prices go down, there will be more and more incentive for people to go to the Moon and make it more and more like Las Vegas. Because eventually, that is the fate of the Moon. Tourism isn't the only industry we can develop. We haven't examined the inner side of the Moon. So, there could be a lot of valuable minerals. If the researchers do find these spots and the profit can be made, people will go and start mining operations. This will require workers. Those workers will need food, that food needs to be made, so restaurants and coffees can be built, and so on. If we can't find any large source of valuable minerals on the Moon, it can still be used as a jumping-off point for the future asteroid mining operations. In this way, the Moon base will be more like Istanbul. There was no valuable resource to use in Istanbul, but its location made it rich. The Moon has much better environment for space exploration. If you need $10 million worth of materials for a single liftoff with a rocket, just by the merit of being smaller, the Moon has less gravity that needs to be overpowered. Add to that a simple fact of not having the atmosphere, so there is little to no resistance to the rocket. So, using the Moon for the future space exploration would be a no-brainer. The Moon will be the second place we will call home. But what comes after we colonize the Moon? Well, by proximity, the next obvious place to go would be the red planet itself – Mars. We will talk about that in second video of this series. Consider subscribing if you like this video. That way, you're helping us make better and more intriguing videos. Thank you for watching, and we will meet in the next one.